Go, set a watchman. Let him declare what he sees. Watchman, what of the night? I set watchman over you, saying, listen to the sound of the trumpet. Son of man, I have made you a watchman for the house of Israel, and give them warning from me. Watch, stand fast in the faith. Be brave, be strong, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ. Inspired men, through their work of revealing and confirming the gospel, engaged in the God-given work of watching for the souls of men.
We're going to talk about midnight tonight, and we're going to abide in Exodus chapter 11 and 12 for a little while. And so if you'll turn to your Bibles in Exodus chapter 11, we're going to cover that just a couple of verses there, but we're going to do chapter 12 quite extensively, and hopefully we'll assist you to prepare for the final hour that we're approaching, because I believe that the midnight hour is arriving, and it's just before us right now. Exodus chapter 11, verse 4 and 5. I want to read verse 4 and 5. And Moses said, thus says the Lord, about midnight. Now, I tell you, when the Lord says something, does he mean it? Yes. About midnight is exactly being fulfilled. And it says, about midnight will I go out in the midst of Egypt, and all the firstborn in the land of Egypt shall die, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sitteth on the throne to the firstborn of the maidservant. In other words, everybody, every female who had a child, a firstborn, is going to die. That is, and also all the firstborn of the beasts. So here we have that all the firstborns of the horses, of the cattle, of the sheep or goats, and all of humanity in Egypt, the firstborn was going to die. And so now I want to go, I don't want to dwell on that verse because we're going to dwell on it in chapter 12. I want to show you the preparations that is absolutely and categorically necessary for us to be ready in the final hour. And so here God is directing us and giving us the direction under chapter 12, even though it was in the days of Moses, but he's also going to fulfill it in the days of the final generation. And look at chapter 12 for a few minutes. We're going to look at it. And it's, I'm going to start with verse 3. Speak unto all the congregation of Israel, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take unto them every man a lamb, according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for a house. And I want to skip, and I want us to go to verse 5. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year. You shall take it out of from the sheep or from the goats. And then I want to go to verse 7. And then it says here, and they shall take the blood. They're going to, in other words, they're going to slay the lamb. But this is the Passover. A Passover is being introduced for the first time. And it says they're going to take the blood and strike it on the two posts and on the upper doorposts of the house wherein they shall eat. So what they had to do was take the blood and put it on the two doorposts, and where else? On the lintel or the top as well. What if they had only put it on the lintel? What if they had only put it on the two posts and forgot the top? Oh, I can't reach it. Exactly. God instructed them to do that. And then it goes on to say in verse 8, and I'm going to cover this all in detail, but I want to go through it first. I'm going to read it, and then I want to cover the detail, how it pertains to us in this final hour that we're in. Because we are approaching the midnight hour, and we will study that. And then verse 8, and you shall eat the flesh in that night. You shall roast with a fire, with unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs you shall eat it. Now notice verse 9. I want to emphasize this. Eat not of it raw, nor sodden at all with water, but roast it with fire, with the head and with his legs and with the appurtenance thereof. In other words, this lamb was supposed to be put on the entire lamb. Normally, they cut the head off. Normally, under sacrifices and so forth, they cut the head off. But here, the head was not to be removed, the tail, nor the legs, nor anything touched of the lamb. And we're going to study that as well. It had to be the whole lamb had to be laid on the altar and roasted and eaten. And then it says there, if there's anything, verse 10, anything remained, you were to burn it with fire. And now I want to come to verse 11. Verse 11, we're going to concentrate very heavily on in a few minutes, but right now I'm just reading it. I want to read the whole story first so that you will understand. Then look at verse 11. And you shall eat it. How? With your pajamas. With your night pajamas. No. You are to be dressed, it says there, the loins girded. Now, my dear people, God is directing this. As a matter of fact, Jesus Christ himself is speaking through Moses. What they are to do, the conditions outlined in celebrating the Passover and to save your life and to preserve your life. And so here we have, you are to have your loins girded and what? Go barefooted with your shoes on your feet. And your staff. Why the staff? With the staff, they guided the sheep. That was their comfort, to guide the sheep and or to protect them from wolves or whatever might be out there. That was why they had the staff. And then it goes on to say, and you shall eat it. Oh, just relax in front of a television and just eat your meal. Is that what it said? No. Eat it with haste. Don't fool around. Don't sleep. I'll be awake, ready to do everything, loins girded, shoes on your feet, the staff in your hand, and to eat that lamb and unleavened bread with herbs in a hurry. Because the midnight hour is approaching. He was probably talking to them, maybe 10 o'clock. I don't know. It was just before midnight. That was the point. And I tell you, my dear people, we're going to cover this regarding the final hour that we're living in. And then I want just to go to verse 12. For I will pass through the land this night. In Egypt, of course. This night. And will smite all the firstborn of Egypt. Then I want to go to verse 13. And the blood shall be to you for a token unto the houses whereon ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you, but only on the land of Egypt. God is protecting them. Jesus Christ is preserving already through Moses. He is preserving his eternal sacrifice in those days, he hasn't offered his sacrifice yet, but he wanted to lead them to this eternal sacrifice that he's going to provide for not only the children of Israel, but for all nations, tongue, kindred, and people. And then it goes on to say, I want us to go to verse 14 and 15. I'm going to skip verse 14. I want to go to verse 15. I'm trying to save time here. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread, and the first day you shall put away the leaven of what? What are you supposed to do with the leaven that you have in the house? Put it in your refrigerator. Oh, no, put it in your cabinet and just keep it there. No. It says, to the first day you shall put away the leaven out of your houses. For whosoever eateth leavened bread for the first day to the seventh day, his soul shall be cut off. And verse 17, and ye shall observe the feast of unleavened bread, for in the selfsame day I have brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore you shall observe this day in your generations by the ordinance forever. And by the way, that was fulfilled until the very last Passover that Jesus participated himself before the crucifixion. My dear people, God is leading his people back there in Israel. He was leading his people then in Jerusalem. And now he's leading his people in this final hour, which we will discuss the details. I just want to go through the story first. Then look at verse 19. 7 days there should be no leaven found in your houses. I just want to ask you a question. Does the Lord mean what he says? But are we following what the Lord is directing us to do? And we're going to cover it. I don't want to cover it right now. We're going to come to this point. And then it goes on to say, and you should eat nothing unleavened in verse 20. And then I want to come, because we're going to emphasize also dramatically verse 22. I want to go to that verse. And ye shall take a bunch of hyssop. It was a herbal type of plant. A hyssop, and she'll take the blood and put it on the lintel, which is the top part of the two doorposts on the side with the blood, and none of you shall go out of the door of the house until morning. You are to remain behind those door in the house with the blood on the doorpost and on the lintel or the top. And the Lord will pass through, verse 23, and smite the Egyptians. And when he seeth the blood in the lintel on the two side posts, that's four times it's repeating the side posts and the lintel or the top. Four times. So God is emphasizing dramatically what they are to do. And then I want you to notice that what mean ye, verse 26, what mean ye this service? It is this, in verse 27 is the answer. It is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, who passed over the houses of the children of Israel in Egypt. And when he smote the Egyptians, delivered our houses, and the people bowed the head and worshiped. Now I want to go to verse 29. And as I said, I'm reviewing this first to give you a picture of what God desired of the children of Israel in the days of Moses, when he introduced the Passover. And then it says here in verse 29, and it came to pass when? At midnight. What did he announce in chapter 11? At midnight. And it says here, and it came to pass. It arrived. Midnight arrived. And he smote the firstborn of the land of Egypt. And then it goes on to say that in verse 30, there was a great cry in Egypt. For there was not one house where there wasn't one, not one dead. As a matter of fact, many of the houses had two dead. What did they have dead? According to chapter 12, verse 12. In many of the houses, they had two dead. Who were the two dead? The firstborn of who? Of man and who? And beast. My dear people, this is very interesting because God fulfills his word. He does not change. Malachi chapter 3 tells us he does not change. What he says, it goes. But the point is this, are we willing to fulfill those conditions outlined in chapter 12? To leave the world, to leave Egypt, and go ahead to the land of Canaan. And then I want notice in verse 31, and he called Moses and Aaron in the morning. When did he call Moses? It was still night. It was just shortly after midnight, because it didn't take hours to put to death the humanity, the firstborns. No, I believe it was within minutes. Every house suffered under the hand of God. And I tell you, my dear people, he said, and then he called up and says, rise up. Pharaoh says to Moses and to Aaron, rise up, get you forth. And then I want to go to the word and go serve the Lord. In other words, go. Rise up. Don't waste any time. I want you to leave immediately. And of course, that was the whole idea of it. Make haste to be girded, to have your shoes on, and everything else. And then it goes on to say, in verse 32, be gone and bless me also. And then verse 33, and the Egyptians were what? Urgent. And it says there, and urgent upon the people that they might send them out to the land in haste. There's the word haste again. So my dear people, God is preparing his people today. But I tell you something, we have been around too long. We have been around way too long. I want to read something to you from the Spirit of Prophecy. I'm not going to read it. I'm going to give you the references, but I don't have the, I had to cut my sermon dramatically because my sermon is an hour and a half and I have to cut it down to 50 minutes. But I want to read something to you. Christ could have come ere this. Ellen White wrote this. Ellen White wrote this, that Christ could have come ere this. Or she said that Christ would have come. Or Christ was planning to come and you were not ready. And I'm going to read to you what I got from the Spirit of Prophecy. 1851, First Elected Messages, page 68. 1856, I'm giving you only the dates. I don't have time to read them. But that's basically all these quotations that I have here are the dates. I want to just give you the dates. That's my purpose. 1856, One Testimonies, page 131. 1883, Evangelism, page 695. 1884, Four Spirit of Prophecy, 281. 1888, Great Controversy, 458. 1904, Eight Testimonies, 115. 1892, Review and Herald, May 7th, 1892. And Review and Herald, 311, 1890. She wrote this, that Jesus could have come in those years. 1888, Review and Herald, July 31, 1888. 1898, Desire of Ages, page 633, 634. 1900, Six Testimonies, page 450. 1903, Evangelism, 694. 1901, First Elected Messages, 82. Testimonies to Ministers, page 90, plus a few extra pages after that. And Last Day Events, page 37 to 39. 14 references. I tell you, my dear people, God is preparing his people, and here we are 168 years later, and we're still here. And just like, you know, it's amazing, I'm used to Pastor Doug because Pastor Doug did our evangelism in Kenya in November, but Pastor John spoke last night about getting ready, about the final hour. And it's amazing that Demario was talking about getting ready, the latter rain. And it's amazing that God asked me to talk about the midnight hour, to be ready. That Christ is looking for us to be ready. He's anxious to come. And now I believe with all my heart, as I review everything, we're coming so close to the end that it's awesome. Now, I want us to go to one more verse in chapter 12. I'm sorry I'm rushing, but I want to emphasize this dramatic. And it's still back to Exodus chapter 12, verse 37. And 37, no, we're going to skip 37, go to 38. And the mixed multitude went up also with them, the flocks and the herds very much cattle. And by the way, how did the Egyptians end up going with them? Do you think they painted their doorposts and lintels with blood? Huh? I have a reference here from I'll give the reference to you right away. Three spiritual gifts, page 214, that the mixed multitude went in with the Israelites behind the post, behind the doors, where the blood was on the doorposts and on the top, and they were all saved as well. So my dear people, what are we doing to invite the mixed multitude into our churches? What are we doing? I want to go into the practical point of the final hour. What does this chapter 11 and chapter 12 have to do with 2012? And this is what I want to share with you. And I want us to go to the blood first. The blood of the Lamb, which saved Israel and the mixed multitude, the people from Babylon, from the Roman Catholic Church, from the Pentecostal in Africa right now. We are studying dramatically with evangelical brethren. 38 members of a church want to find out more about the Sabbath and the second coming of Christ. And one of our workers started talking about the state of the dead. And now they want to know about the state of the dead. And now we have a Pentecostal church with 25 people. The owner of the land and the man who built the church, Pentecostal church. Became baptized into the Seventh-day Adventist church. And through our Bible worker wrote an email to me and said, please, he wants to donate the church to the Pentecostal church, to the Seventh-day Adventist people, Advent Hope Ministry, and he wants to sell the additional land for expansion in the future because the church is small and only seat about 30, 40 people. And my dear people, and we told them, yes, we're going to work together. And they're preparing right now 13 people from the Pentecostal church to be baptized. I tell you, my dear people, God is waiting for Babylon, mixed multitude. But let's go to the blood. I want us to turn to 1 Peter. Now, please use your Bibles. Please, please, please. I tell you, unless we begin to use the Word of God, His flesh and His blood, we are going to lose out. So use your Bibles here as we study. This is strictly a study. I'm not trying to preach. If I am starting to preach, I want to stop. I just want to study the Bible. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 19. The blood. I just want to show you what the blood of Moses' day is doing for the blood with the blood today and with all people from the time of Adam and Eve to the very time of the last person born on earth. Verse 19, but with the precious blood of Christ as the Lamb without blemish and without spot. Now, I want to ask you the question, what did I read in Exodus chapter 12 about the Lamb? It said, a male of less than 1 year and what else? Without blemish. There we have applying to our day today. Without blemish, the Lamb of God. And we're washed in the precious blood of the Lamb. And I want us to go to Psalms 51:7. Psalm 51:7. Very interesting here about the blood. I just want to dwell on the blood for a few minutes. And we're going to continue on. I want to try to complete the message today. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me and I'll be whiter than snow. And verse 10, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. And by the way, where do we learn about the word hyssop? What do they use to put the blood on a doorpost? Hyssop. And here David is saying, cleanse me with that hyssop because there's blood on the hyssop. I want to be washed. I want to have a new heart, and I want to have a new mind. So God is speaking to his people. I want us to look at Nine Testimonies, page 194. Nine Testimonies, page 194, and I'm just going to tell you what it says, is that we are to be washed and cleansed by having the blood-stained banner of Jesus Christ. Do you have a blood-stained banner in your life? Are you clinging to the blood-stained banner? And by the way, I didn't bring it with me. I meant to bring it with me. I have testimonies all in one book. I want to recommend it to you. I know Steps to Life have it here. Testimonies all in one book. We gave those out in East Africa Union to 642 conference pastors and leaders of East Africa Union and all the local conferences. 692 pastors and main leaders received it. And I tell you, did you know that 90%, 90 to 95% of the leaders of a Seventh-day Adventist church under East Africa Union have never seen a testimony? And when I got the local conference president of the local conference of the Seventh-day Adventist church, when I first met him, he was very cool towards me, because he thinks that I'm historic or independent. We're self-reporting. But you know what happened in March when I was there? It was November. He was grateful. He says, I never knew that testimonies had so much admonition, so much advice for pastors as well as for the members of a church. The local conference president, it's called South Kenya Conference, the president. And I tell you, I said, even if one soul is saved, by the way, Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17 says, if there's a soul saved on earth, what goes on in heaven? Zephaniah 3, 17. They're singing. And who's singing? Not the only angels. It tells us there that the Father. Can you imagine the God, the Father, singing over one soul saved? I tell you, this is our work, to do what we can to assist even the conference area, to wake up in this mighty, mighty hour. I want us to go, and also 7 Testimonies, page 30, tells us to stand under the bloodstained banner of Jesus Christ. 7T, page 30. I want us to go to one more. 1 John chapter 1. 1 John regarding the blood. I just want to dwell on the blood and we're moving on. And I want us to notice in chapter 1 John chapter 1 verse 7 and 9. But we walk in the light, and as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ his Son cleanses all from all sin. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, from all earthliness, from all fleshliness, from all selfishness. God is willing to cleanse and purify us. And now I want us to go to the Lamb. There in chapter 12 of Exodus, they brought the Lamb. And if you remember, the lamb was whole. The lamb was not broken in any way or cut up in any way except to drain the blood. And so we're told, and look at John chapter 6. I want us to know what is it talking about as far as the lamb is concerned? John chapter 6. John chapter 6. Moses experienced that with the lamb back there in Egypt, and now we're finding out about the lamb today. And look at verse 51. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat this bread, he shall live forever. And the bread that I shall give is what? His flesh. And I will give for the life of the world. Verse 53. Except ye eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life. 54. Whosoever eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood has eternal life. I will raise him up in the last day. And listen to what he says. And look at this. For my flesh is meat and dead, and my blood is drinking dead. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. So Christ, if you eat his flesh and drink his blood, which is the word of God, you have Christ abiding within you and we in him. And it says, as living Father has sent me, I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. Oh, my dear people, God is trying to lead his people to eat the Lamb of God, to absorb the Lamb of God, to drink the Lamb of God, spend time with the Lamb of God, and you shall be cleansed. Desire of Ages. I don't have time to read the entire paragraph. I'm just going to read only the two lines. To eat and drink. Listen to this carefully. To eat and to drink the flesh or the blood of Christ is to receive Christ as a personal Savior. And my dear people, are we to do that weekly? Moment by moment. I just heard her say, her lip, I couldn't hear her, but I watched her lips, and her lips said, moment by moment. We live moment by moment. I breathe moment by moment. And we're to live in Christ Jesus. Yes, maybe we can spend time searching the scripture right there and then, but can we uplift our hearts? Oh, God, I need you. Direct my life. Direct my our work. Direct me and lead me in whatever there's wrong with me. Show me. You know, the problem with me, I'm an impatient man. Before I was reconverted and I rejoined the church and met my dear wife and married her, she would have never married me if she would have met me before I was reconverted, because I was in the world. I was very successful in business. And I later made a lot of money, had fun. But when I was reconverted by, help me, honey, Pastor Short and Pastor Wieland in Collegedale, when they presented a whole week of righteousness by faith, my first wife died from cancer. And I told the lady who invited me to come, I told her, I got no time for that. But she was a good friend, and she was a very godly woman. I don't know what she saw in me, because I was of the world. But she says to me, please go. So to make a long story short, I went. I decided, well, I'll go one night and tell her, that's enough for me. I don't need that stuff. But you know what happened that night? Exactly 21 years ago, this summer, in June, 21 years ago, I was reconverted and rebaptized. I was converted that night, and I attended every meeting thereafter. The point is this, my dear people, God is waiting for you. Maybe some of us aren't fully in the world, but we're a little careless with the Word of God. Maybe we're just a little careless of how we are eating His flesh and drinking His blood and getting to know Him as a personal Savior. But God is urging us. I want us to go to point number two of Exodus chapter 12. Remember, the second point was this. We are to be girded. Our loins are to be girded, right? There will be clothed. I want to show you something from Isaiah chapter 61:10. I'm sure many of you know this text, but go to 61:10. I want to show you what we're to be girded with. God is preparing his people. And that's what I needed 21 years ago. I needed this particular gird dramatically. Look what it says there. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garment of salvation. Justification. I don't have time to talk about it. But we're justified. We're convinced that we're sinners and we need help. We need the precious blood of the law of Jesus Christ. So he's clothed me with the garment of salvation, and he has covered me with a robe of righteousness. Are you clothed with the robe of righteousness, sanctification? Even though you just put it on? Listen, my dear people, regardless of where you come from and what you have been doing, Christ is ready to clothe you with a garment of salvation and a robe of righteousness. And I want us to go to another point now. I want us to go to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 14. Ephesians chapter 6, 14. Look at this. I want the Bible, the spirit of prophecy, to answer the point of Moses leading the children of Israel to the land of Canaan, as today, through the spirit of prophecy, through the word of God, we're being led to the land of Canaan for eternity. And look what it says in verse 14. Stand ye therefore, having your what? Loins girt with what? The truth. Who's the truth? Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. And so God is saying here, I want to have you girded with the truth and having the breastplate of righteousness. Oh, my dear people, I want us to go to one more quotation on girded, and then we're going to move on. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end for the grace that's to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. My dear people, he wants to gird us with the loins. Notice that? Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind and be sober. Are we thinking clearly? Is the law written upon our hearts and in our minds? Are we doing the law of God with love and practice and so forth? Okay, I want to go now to the shoes of your feet. I wish I had more time. I'm going to read one more if you don't mind. I've got to read this one. The last book of the Bible, Revelation chapter 7. Let's go to chapter 7, verse 9. I want you to notice this. And it's vital, vital, vital. And let me tell you, if you think you're going to have white robes in heaven, where are you going to put them on? In heaven? Huh? Right now. Right here. Listen to this. Verse 9. And I beheld a great multitude which no man could number. All the nations, kindreds, peoples, and tongues stood before the throne, before the Lamb. How? Clothed with white robes and the palms in their hands. And look at verse 13. And one of the elders said to me, what are these that are arrayed in white robe? And whence came they? Verse 14, I said to them, sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, these are they which came out of the great tribulation and have washed their robes. When? When they got to heaven? No, here on earth. They washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. So you see how important the blood is, the wearing, the being girded with the loins. And now I want to go to, real quickly, to the shoes of your feet. Romans chapter 10, verse 15. Romans chapter 10, verse 15. And it's amazing how the Bible puts it all together in the New Testament for the last generation. We have no excuse. Yeah, we could say, well, that was the time of Moses. But, roughly 4,000 years ago. But no, he's talking to us today through Apostle Paul. And look what it says in chapter 10, verse 15. And how shall we preach except we be sent? And that is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring good tidings of good things. Our feet. Oh, my dear people. And now Apostle Peter answers those feet about the gospel. And the beautiful, like it says here, the beautiful. Beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel and the glad tidings of good things. Now, listen to what Apostle Peter says. It's still Apostle Paul. I'm sorry. It's Ephesians chapter 6. Chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 15. And your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. And so, my dear people, Are your feet shod with the gospel peace? Are you ready to do your part into finishing this work? Whatever talent that you may have that God is calling you, but God is calling us all. We have different talents, but God is calling us all into one harmony. I tell you, How? Through the precious blood of the Lamb. Isaiah chapter 52, verse 7. How beautiful upon the mountains are the feet. Who? The feet of him that bringeth good tidings and publisheth peace and brings good tidings of good, that publisheth salvation, that saith unto the Zion that God reigneth. And just as DeMario brought out this morning, what is Zion for those who were here this morning? Jerusalem. And for us, it's New Jerusalem. Oh, my dear people, are you prepared? Are you prepared to do your little part, whether it be this much, or those who have got more light and more talent to do this much, to finish this work? And God is leading us dramatically. I want us to go to the staff, now. Remember, we read the staff, about the staff. They were to be girded. They were to have their feet, their shoes on their feet, and they were to have their staff in their hand. I want us to go to Ephesians chapter 6:16. Ephesians chapter 6:16. Above all, take the shield of faith. The staff was their shield, was a shield for their sheep to lead them and to guide them and to and also it was a shield to keep away the wolves or any wild animal that would try to attack the sheep. That was the purpose of their staff, and to guide them as well. So here we have the shield of faith. I'm going to go ahead and quote one more to you. Psalm 84, verse 9 and 11. Behold, O God, our shield, and look upon the face of thy anointed. And verse 11, for the Lord God is the sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly with him. And now I want to cover quickly, go to the next point. Eat in haste. And if you remember, the Pharaoh asked them to leave in haste. Nine Testimonies, page 135. The end is near. My dear people, the end is near. Time is short. Night cometh. I like to add a little bit to it. Midnight is coming. Present the truth now. Make haste to impart it to others. I want to read you from Country Life. I have a book here, Country Life, page 21. And it tells us here, I see the necessity of the people of God to leave the cities and get into the country. And that's the paragraph, but I can't read the whole paragraph because of time. Thus may you bring up your children up with simple, healthful habits. I see the necessity. This is the quote that I want. I see the necessity of making haste to get ready for what? A crisis. I see the necessity of getting ready. I want to make one more. Listen to this. Treasure every light that you receive from the Word of God. It says, treasure every ray of light. Do you treasure every ray of light that you receive from the Word of God and from the Spirit of prophecy? And then it goes on to say, I have to skip, make haste to obtain the fitness for the mansions which Christ has gone to prepare for all them that love him. The day is far spent. The night is at hand. Midnight hour is coming. It's right now. I really believe the midnight hour has begun. Make haste to ripen for heaven. The problem with many of us, we're still green fruit. We're not ripe. We're not ripe with the character of Christ. We're not ripe with the perfection of his character. And therefore, it says, make haste to ripen for heaven. Review and Herald, May the 30th, 1882. So, my dear people, God is calling us. I want to read to you Zephaniah chapter 1. Zephaniah chapter 1, verse 14. The great day of the Lord is near. It is near, and it hasteth greatly. It's coming. Don't delay. God is calling you. What are we waiting for? I really believe, as Pastor John brought out, and even Demario was talking about the latter, early and latter rain. I believe that if our people would be of one accord, this work would be finished. Amen. We would go be filled with the Holy Spirit and go forward in haste. No more fooling around. Our feet shod and our loins girded with the righteousness of Christ, and we would just be. As a matter of fact, Ellen White even tells us our faces would be shining with the righteousness of Christ. And then it goes on to say, verse 15, the day of wrath, the day of trouble. This is darkness, my dear. This is midnight hour. The day of wasteness, the day of desolation, the day of darkness, the day of clouds and thick darkness. Oh, my dear people, God is calling us dramatically to begin to make changes. Listen to this. I read to you earlier 12 quotations that Christ could have come from 1851 to 1904. Ellen G. White wrote that Christ could have come 12 times, different dates. Look what she says finally in early writings, page 67. What we have been learning for years, we'll be learning in a few months, in this final hour. They had to learn in one night in Exodus chapter 12. In one night, that night, God, through Moses, says, put the blood around the doorposts. Prepare for this and this and this, as we read. We're going to have to learn in a few months. That's all we're going to have. So, my dear people, are you ready today? Are you ready today? If you're not ready today, you will not be ready later on either. So, my dear people, God is calling us. And listen to this. Listen to this. We are now come to the close of Earth's history. We either rapidly advance or what? Rapidly retrograde. Review and Herald, December the 13th, 1892, page 770. So my question to you again is, are you ready? Are you doing anything at all? Unleavened bread. Unleavened bread. It talked about unleavened bread. And Patriarchs and Prophets, page 278. I can only read the one line to save time. The leaven of sin. Did you hear that? The leaven of sin must be put away. Just like Demario was talking about the alcoholic. He had to put it away. And the point is this. What were they supposed to do with the leaven in the houses for 7 days? Not only to eat unleavened bread, but to throw out the leaven that they had in their houses. That's what Exodus chapter 12 was talking about. So, my dear people, what kind of health reformers are you? Are you still clinging to white rice, white macaroni, white flour, white sugar, white potatoes? Are you still clinging to potato chips, crackers? Huh? Are you practicing health reform? Medical ministry, page 159, paragraph 5. Gospel includes, listen to this, the cross is the gospel. It includes health reform in all its phases. Medical ministry, page 159, and Counsel's Diet and Foods, page 75. Listen to this, 6 Testimonies, 379. The gospel is bound up in the principle of health reform. You can accuse me all you want, but I stand behind these words. These are not my opinions. These are not my development or whatever. Listen to this, the third one. The work of health reform, guess what? Features the gospel. The gospel of health. 6 Testimonies, page 327. So my dear people, God is calling us. God is calling us right now. And I want to read to you also Desire of Ages, page 122. It says here, our only hope. Listen to this. Our only hope of eternal life. The land of Canaan, as Israel was going. The only hope of eternal life is through bringing our appetite into subjection to the will of God. Does God mean what he says when he talks about health reform? I have in my Bible, I carry it wherever I go, all these quotations on health reform. That's how much health reform. 200 quotations. There's more, but I just selected the best. I thought the best were 200, but there's many good ones besides. So my dear people, God is calling us to have unleavened bread. And it's time, and I'm not saying for us to eat unleavened bread today. That's not the direction. It was for the Passover. But I'm going to the spiritual aspect. What does God expect from us? Rest. Well, God bless you, and let us close with prayer. Our Father in heaven, I just pray in a very special way that the Holy Spirit may guide and direct our hearts and our thoughts. We need the baptism of the Holy Spirit and with fire to create purity in our hearts and to fill us with holy zeal in our feet to share the beautiful gospel of peace and to prepare in a special way for eternity. And Father, whatever we must give up, it is time to do it now. Clothe us with the robe of righteousness. Please, I plead, that we may reveal Christ, not only at home, in the church, but to the community. And so guide and direct us, I pray, in a special way. And sustain us, I pray, in Jesus' name.